Members, this is the appointed time and we have a quorum. Welcome to the panel on Information Technology and Broadcasting. Item 1, the Secretariat has not issued any papers since the last meeting. Item 2, items for discussion at the next meeting. The next meeting is scheduled for 2:30 p.m. on the 14th of October this year. The administration is still considering the items for discussion at the next meeting. Members will be informed of the proposed items in due course. Item 3, latest enhancement of IM Smart. Members, if you want to ask questions, please press the button to indicate so. Let me invite the administration to come in first. Let me welcome Undersecretary and her team to our meeting, as well as Mr. Tony Wong, Government Chief Information Officer. So, Undersecretary will first deliver opening remarks, and I suppose Mr. Tony Wong will then walk us through the paper with a PowerPoint presentation. Yes, Madam Chair, members, I'm pleased to be able to attend today's meeting to brief members on the progress of the enhancement of IM Smart. IM Smart is an important infrastructure in the development of a digital government. At the moment, it supports over 380 online services provided by the government and public and private organizations. Over 2.7 million Hong Kong residents have registered for IM Smart, with a daily average of over 100,000 logins. By 2025, the government's target is to have full adoption of IM Smart to realize the goal of single portal for online government services. Last year, we proposed a full upgrade of IM Smart platform so as to provide better service integration, enhance user experience, and bring more convenience to the public and business. After seeking funding approval from LegCo in May last year, we immediately started our work. We also invited members of the public to take part in our workshops so as to co-design the user face of IM Smart so as to achieve a citizen-centric objective. In October last year, we updated the design of the homepage for the IM Smart for citizens to browse various sorts of practical daily life information just by launching the app and checking the web the homepage. This year, we also streamlined the registration process. With the use of the NFC feature, near-field communication, that is, of the mobile phones, users will be able to register for IM Smart or IM Smart Plus by allowing the app to read the hard face data in the new ID card chip. We'll also promote the use of personal code called IM Smart Personal Code Function to provide a simple identification function for event attendance or property management. We will further enhance user experience by improving different features. On strengthening system capacity, performance, and security, in October last year, IM Smart Platform successfully obtained the ISO IEC 2022 and ISO ESC 27701 2019 international standard certifications, which prove that the services have reached international standards in information security and personal data protection. In light of the escalating cybersecurity risks, we are now developing log analysis and monitoring technologies by leveraging AI to assist in the operational management of the platform. The system will be able to conduct anomaly detection and system management, proactively identifying and getting alerts on potential system issues. We'll also upgrade the IM Smart System infrastructure so as to enhance capacity to cope with ad hoc surge in service demand and increasing utilization. Like Madam Chair said, I'm going to give the floor to Mr. Daniel Zhang, Assistant Government Chief Information Officer of OGO, to brief you on their work, and following that, I'll be happy to take questions from members. Yes, Assistant GCIO, Mr. Zhang. Thank you. In the following, I'd like to brief members on the progress on the enhancement of I Am Smart. I Am Smart platform at present has over 2.7 registered users, and it's close to 2.8 million users. We also support over 380 online services provided by the government and public-private organizations. In the middle of last year, with the support of members, we sought funding approval of around $193 million. And following that, we immediately started the enhancement of I Am Smart. We engaged a consultant to redesign the user interface and the workflow of I Am Smart. And in October last year, we updated the design of the homepage for I Am Smart so that without logging in, members of the public will be able to check the homepage for various sorts of practical daily life information such as local weather, traffic conditions, real-time cross-harbor tunnel tolls, waiting time for A&E department in hospitals, etc. This year, we will gradually roll out a number of new functions. For example, registration process streamlined for I Am Smart Plus, as well as the step-up authentication service. And I will come to that in a moment. We'll continue to enhance the infrastructure. This year, we'll also introduce the red team to examine the system's ability to enhance the security of the system. In the fourth quarter of this year, we will roll out various measures to enhance user experience, such as a personal assistant page. Next year, we will also roll out a new function for paying government bills. We'll also roll out a platform to host mini apps, and I will come to that in a minute. First, online self-registration for I Am Smart Plus account, and this is a new function. Members of the public can complete a number of simple procedures with the use of their own mobile app for the registration of an I Am Smart Plus account. Now, the process is as follows. They need to take a photograph of the front side of the ID card, and then they need to tap the card to retrieve for the phone to retrieve card face data stored in the chip of the new ID card by using the NFC feature of the mobile phone. And then the system will check the facial recognition data with that stored by the immigration department. And then finally, the user can then set the password and provide an email address, and that will complete the registration process for I Am Smart Plus. I will invite members to watch a clip now. Let's take a look at the latest registration procedures. Just download I Am Smart, and then under sufficient lighting, click registration, and then click age group. After reading the fine print and agreeing to the declaration, we can start the registration procedure. First, put the ID card exactly in the square provided. Take a photograph of the front side, and then following the instruction, tap the card with the phone, and then we can proceed to facial recognition. Follow the instructions to perform certain gestures such as blinking, turning the head to the right or the left. And then you can choose biometrics for unlocking the phone. Set up a 6-digit password for I Am Smart. Provide an email address, and that's it. In just a few steps, you can register for I Am Smart account on your own without having to visit a post office. It's now much more convenient. Well, I think, as you can see in the video clip, registering for an I Am Smart Plus account can be completed in just a minute or so, and it's much more convenient than visiting the self-service kiosks or the post office. I will now turn to another new function of I'm Smart, and that is called the I Am Smart Personal Code. Using this personal code, a user can display their personal data with a QR code. We use digital signing technology, which has the anti-abuse feature. This QR code can be used in different scenarios, such as property management. If you're a visitor, you can show the personal QR code to the property management staff for registration. There is no need to proffer any ID card or provide other personal data. By doing so, we can enhance personal data privacy. We will promote the use of I'm Smart Personal Code at housing estate, as well as signing up for attendance of events. We also attach a lot of importance to enhancing user experience. We're going to roll out a new user interface. Using one-tap login, a user can access some frequently used government services of their choice. We will also make a record of the services bookmarked or services frequently used by the user so that tailor-made menu can be provided for the user. We will also upgrade the eMe function. When applying for other government services, the user can make use of the Consented Data Exchange Gateway or CDEG to retrieve personal data already submitted to other government departments so as to save the user time for filling in repetitive information. We are working out arrangements with other government departments in collecting data for CDEG. We'll also introduce a personal assistant page using CDEG so that a user will be able to browse different information provided by government departments and their personal status, such as government bills, places allocation results, tax returns, etc. We'll also include a government bill payment function next year, so that after checking government bills, a user can then directly pay the bill with faster payment system or FPS. That will also support the digital personal document function. Using I'm Smart, users can store digital personal documents issued by different departments, such as a fishing permit, senior citizen cards, or CRE results. And if necessary, the user can also display the QR code to show proof of the digital personal documents. We will also enhance the function to authenticate the relevant licenses and personal documents. We'll also explore with more government departments so as to include more digital personal documents to enhance user experience. Now, we understand that there is a need for multiple ID authentication function to access certain online services. Again, using NFC, we can provide this option. For example, when conducting online transaction, a multiple identity authentication function may be needed. NFC may be needed to read the face data stored in the cards, or facial recognition technology may be needed so as to authenticate the identity of the user to enhance the security of online trading.
Now, on a platform for functions and features, in the first quarter next year, we will roll out a platform. On this platform, different departments can create functions, allowing people to access their services. By that time, you can log on to I Am Smart, and then you can access those services. you won't have to have a range of different apps on your phone. For departments, this will also mean faster development of apps and lower costs. Now, apart from making the app more user-friendly, we're also getting more public and private bodies to adopt I Am Smart. We now have more than 70 services from private and public sectors on I Am Smart. The applications cover account opening, taking out insurance, activating accounts, renewing registration, and online signature of documents. There's also a list of recognized developers of I Am Smart. This way, firms adopting I Am Smart will also have an easier time finding the developers. We're also working with Cyberport to hold seminars to tell the sector about the latest developments and also share the latest applications. We'll tell them about the latest enhancement for the industry to get involved. On publicity, we work with different departments, district organizations, and bodies. We help people sign up for the app. Here, I want to thank members present for their support and participation. They helped us let more people find out about I Am Smart and provide greater ease for their lives. On social media, we also have pages on I Am Smart. We tell people about the app. The registration kiosks also now cover a wider area. People can sign up online. They can also go for the offline option at those kiosks if they need it. Now, on collaboration with the mainland, the OGCIO established the connection of I Am Smart and the Unified Identity Authentication Platform of Guangdong Province last November. So when our users sign up for the Guangdong platform, they can link it to their I Am Smart account. So going forward, they can log on to the Yuesheng Shi app or the Guangdong platform through I Am Smart. They can access the Guangdong government services. We're in talks with Guangdong about connections with other platforms such as Suihaoban and iShenzhen. Within Guangzhou, Qianhai, Shenzhen, and Hetao, Futian, we also have self-service kiosks for I Am Smart. We will also put in place more self-service kiosks for I Am Smart in other parts of the Greater Bay Area to make it easier for Hong Kong residents to sign up for the app. I will stop here. Thank you. 13 members are lining up to speak. Their names are Professor William Wong, Ms. Eunice Zhou, Mr. Adrian Ho, Mr. Chen Hockfong, Mr. Lam Chen Singh, Mr. Tang Fei, Mr. Chen Xiu Hong, Dr. Dennis Lam, Mr. Li Chenke, Mr. Lok Chung Hong, Mr. Holden Chow, followed by me. 4 minutes for each member, questions and answers inclusive. Professor Wong. Thank you, Madam Chair. Now, I have a question about one-tap login and the enhanced IMEI function. So the idea now is G2C. It's public-facing. Different bodies also use these functions. Would there be a G2B function so that bodies, organizations can use them? For the faster payment system, in Q1 next year, we will see the payment function live. So will the FPS be the only payment option? Will Alipay and WeChat Pay be supported? Departments and semi-public bodies may also need payment options. So would the payment system be open source for other organizations to use it? I support the collaboration with Guangdong. Our system is linked with the Guangdong platform. There are different services on the Guangdong platform. Do we have any plans about prioritizing access to certain functions on the Guangdong province, Undersecretary? Thank you. Now, for one-tap login and the enhanced IMEI function. Now, we support G2C and B2C. Public and private bodies already take part in the IM Smart function. With ID authentication, people can open bank accounts. And when people buy an insurance policy, people can also use the ID verification on IM Smart. Some medical organizations also work with IM Smart. Now, people can verify their ID through IM Smart to verify their identity. This saves these people the trip to go to a hospital to verify their ID. People can also view their medical reports online through IM Smart. For future users such as B2B, we will have the business version of IM Smart, and that is the IM Smart for Business, digital identity of enterprises. Now, on payment, in the future, on IM Smart, people will be able to view their utilities bills. On that platform, people will be able to access faster payment system, and then they can pay their bills. On our work with Guangdong Province, IM Smart is now linked to the Unified Identity Authentication Platform. So people will be able to access the Guangdong services. So people can access the services usually used by people. Professor Wong. Now, verification isn't an issue. G2C and G2B are different when it comes to IMEI. It's not just about your ID card number, it's also your business registration number that's involved. I asked about whether we can have an open sourced payment system. Many bodies need a payment system. Semi-public bodies need this kind of system. My third question about Guangdong Province. Of course, we have to work with Guangdong. But will we try to secure the access to certain services if Hong Kong people living there need them? Tony. On IMEI and one-tap login, the IM Smart platform is a personalized platform. People can access government services or business services on this platform. Now, on corporate ID or IM Smart for Business, there will be an enhanced version of IMEI. That platform will be G2B in nature, meaning businesses will be able to access government services. That platform will be to verify business identities. On payment options, once IM Smart is linked up with the FPS, people can also use the other payment options they are already using. On working with Guangdong, on the cross-boundary government services, we're adding commonly used services onto the platform. There are now over 100 services. We roll out a service once it's ready. If a service requires ID verification, our linked systems already allow people to access those services. Ms. Eunice Yong. Thank you, Madam Chair. I support the use of I'm Smart. I just managed to update my driver's license through I'm Smart. Now I'm Smart is at 3.40, but we're not moving fast enough. We have to wait till 2025 for all the enhancements to come into place. These aren't a large number of enhancements. I'm Smart used to be anything but handy. Now we want to link up I'm Smart with other government services such as Scan Meter or Smart Play or eHealth. We now have a patchwork of mobile apps. So can we have a single app that allows people to access different services? Can that be our direction with I'm Smart? Now, I have a question about the red team exercises. Now, there are scant details on these exercises. So, are we talking about tests for the software? Software design requires white hat tests and black hat tests. Why are we planning a red team exercise for the third quarter? So are we trying to get users' feedback on the system? Now for me, I am Smart used to come without the search function. You had to click it and wait till you get to the third page. When we will see AI chatbot on I am Smart, so that they can identify the app or service they need. Undersecretary. I thank the member for her support. She helped us when we were promoting the app as well. On the timeline, we are working against the clock. We're constantly reviewing and enhancing our platform. We put a vast amount of effort into this round of enhancements. We work with different stakeholders and the public. We take a people-centric approach in our all-rounded enhancements. The current timeline can meet people's needs. This is an ambitious timeline. With the near-field communication technology, you can just tap your ID card and then you can sign up for I am Smart Plus. Behind this function upgrade, a massive amount of work went into the upgrade. This involved many departments, 5 or 6 departments. Next month or later, we will also roll out the I am Smart personal code. This involves engagement with industry players. We have to find applications for the technology. This involves both public and private players. Now, on one-tap login and digital personal documents, these services will be rolled out this year. Our goal is to adopt I am Smart for more than 100 government services. So our answer is, as people say, I am Smart is being enhanced. I am Smart is offering greater convenience to people. People find the app handy. Now I am smart is getting more convenient. With these enhancements, we want I am smart to be a handy tool for people. People have to pay their utilities bills, they have to check their tax demand note. We want people to be able to check everything. They can view their MPF returns. All people may have to apply for textbook or transport allowances for their children. We want people to be able to access these services on I Am Smart. That will be our direction of travel. Now on the red team exercises, Mr. Tony Wong can tell us more.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Ms. Yong, for the question. The idea of introducing a red team to examine the system is to address the escalating risk of cyber attacks and cybersecurity. In fact, for government services, even services provided by private organizations, red team is deployed to enhance system testing. So every year, we engage the so-called white hackers or the specialist tech companies to conduct tests in relation to the platform or the back operations of the I Am Smart, so as to identify areas for improvements and for us to take preemptive action to enhance resilience. This is in fact a common method adopted by major platforms to examine and review the stability and security of computer systems. This is also in line with our approach to enhance user experience, because what is of paramount importance is to ensure system security. Madam Chair, I think you haven't answered this question. I want to know whether this app will also cover e-health, etc. The answer is yes. As mentioned or as proposed by the member, our objective is for all government online services to adopt I Am Smart. At the same time, some apps developed by particular government departments may target a particular group of users, but the overall direction is for full adoption of I Am Smart. And that is why we are going to develop a platform to host various mini apps, which aims at providing government services to the public. Instead of having apps developed by government departments on their own. About the search function, this is also something that we're working on. Mr. Adrian Ho. Thank you, Chair. Let me put in a few good words for the government on developing I Am Smart. At first, it wasn't really handy. Now, it's really convenient. Next time, I hope to see more improvements. In the end of January 2023, over 1.7 million users have registered for I Am Smart, and according to the paper, 2.8 million users have registered. According to the figure at 25th of June 2024, this registration figure is somewhat just less than 50% of the total population in Hong Kong. So I want to know whether there will be any further enhancements to promote I Am Smart and to increase the coverage of I Am Smart. I want to know whether there are any non-Chinese speaking citizens using I Am Smart, and have you looked into whether I Am Smart is providing the help that they need? Now, there are quite a lot of apps developed by government departments. I'm also a registered user of I Am Smart. It covers a lot of government services, but I do find one shortcoming, and that is in relation to the IRD. We are forwarded to different links and pages. Now, Undersecretary mentioned hosting all the services in just one app. Is there a timetable? Have you started coordination with other government departments? Is there a timetable to make sure that one app can host various services? Undersecretary, first of all, I thank Mr. Adrian Ho for acknowledging the work on enhancement of I'm Smart. Now, on the number of registered users, we aim at enhancing not only the registration figure but also the quality of services. That means we want to enhance user experience, make it convenient for citizens. We deliver the services most needed to the public through an easy-to-use interface of I'm Smart. The target is for the full adoption of I'm Smart by all government online services by 2025. So these are the two prongs we place emphasis on. On the number of registered users in May 2023, we recorded some 2 million users. 1 year on, the figure has increased by close to 800,000. Apart from the number of registered users, we should also take a look at the utilization rate. The target was to reach 10 million logins, and that by 2025 it should reach 17.5. But at the end of 2023, we recorded 30 million. So that's a threefold increase comparing to the original target. With enhancement of I'm Smart, we are seeing a surge in both the number of registered users and the utilization rate. That means it has gained wider acceptance. Now, the member mentioned one important aspect, and that's promotion. Indeed, we've ramped up our efforts, and I'd also like to thank members here for helping us promote I'm Smart in their own constituencies. In fact, we've approached elderly centres and we've enlisted the help of organisations to promote I'm Smart to make it more convenient for the public, and we'll continue to ramp up publicity efforts. On non-ethnic Chinese, this is something that we'll look into. Now, to take your third question about one-tap login, the member asked about the timetable. Our goal is to enhance this function of one-tap login within this year so that you don't need to be taken to different web pages. Mr. Tony Wong can take the question on the NEC. The I'm Smart platform does not keep background information on personal data of the users, save for some very basic information. So Mr. Ho was concerned about the ethnicity of users. Well, some government services are provided in multiple languages. And surely we can work with different government departments. Perhaps we can conduct a user survey so as to collect more data in this regard. But as far as using I'm Smart is concerned, the platform does not keep any data relating to the background of users. Next, Mr. Chen Haofeng. Thank you, Chair. I have a number of questions for the administration. First, about red team to step up system testing. As I understand, red team will examine the firewall and possible cyber attacks. I am Smart has everything to do with personal data privacy. So I want to know whether the data are encrypted. Even in the event of data leaks, if data are encrypted, then there won't be a major problem. So my question is on data encryption and to what extent. The next question is about the various government services offered and the personal data involved. Is there an option for users to choose what data should be disclosed to which organization? Say, for cross-boundary public services, if I am to apply for a license, is it possible for me just to provide the information supporting the application instead of disclosing everything to the authority? I think this is a matter of public concern, because otherwise the access to my account would mean disclosure of all information. The third point is about the personal code or the QR code to facilitate registration as a visitor by property management. Again, there is a privacy concern. With just a quick scan of the code, is it possible that the property management will have all my data, including information about where I live, and also some users may need to handle applications on behalf of their parents or children. Say, is it possible to file applications as a family? That means I can have access to the data of my parents or children as well. Undersecretary, I'll give the floor to the GCIO. Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chen, for your questions about data encryption. I'm smart. Platform collects only basic personal data. We will not collect what is more than necessary, and then the data are also encrypted. So that's basically the arrangements. The next point is about consented data exchange gateway. Through CDEG, we can collaborate with different government departments and help users fill in application forms for the purpose of different government services. Users at this point can choose to give authorization. So there are boxes for users to tick. For all the government services provided in I'm Smart, we follow the Personal Data Privacy Ordinance, and we don't collect personal data more than is necessary. The member also asked about the I'm Smart personal code. In fact, we have discussed with different sectors on the different user scenarios of I'm Smart. The major property management companies have their own systems for registration of visitors. However, there are instances in which they may have collected personal data which is more than necessary for the purpose, because the staff would need to check the personal ID card for registration. So the personal code seeks to streamline this process. We use a QR code to provide some of the personal data of the user. That means the code is a unique record of this user, and it will only be matched against the I'm Smart database if necessary. This way, we can guarantee maximum protection of personal data. The property management company, likewise, only keeps a record. They will not have access to the personal data of the users, which is kept at the back end. This is, in fact, a very safe design, and at the same time, we discuss with the property management companies for them to upgrade their systems. In fact, we are working out an arrangement with these PMCs so that they can put in place this new function in their systems to offer better safeguards for personal data whilst performing the function of visitor registration. Mr. Chen also mentioned a very good suggestion. This function of I'm Smart seeks to provide personal identity authentication. And Mr. Chan has suggested incorporating the data of the children of the user in the same account. We'll give it a thought. The important thing is to provide convenience.
Mr. Lam Chen Sing, please be brief in your comments. Thank you, Madam Chair. To write on Mr. Adrian Ho's question, the government and the OGCIO are working hard on publicity. But now we only have 2.7 million registered users. We need more registered users. Do we have a target on the number? Or is there a target? Say, do we have an age group where few people use the app, or they seniors? After seniors see those clips about scams, they are hesitant to have this app installed. And when seniors do try to sign up, they struggle with taking pictures and leaving their fingerprints. We talked about digital inclusion. We know the government committed enormous resources, which went to NGOs to help seniors use the technology. So can we have a target on boosting seniors' uptake of the app? Many services on the platform are suitable for seniors. Now, I turn to paragraph 13. And this is the digital personal document. Senior citizens' cards are one example of this kind of document. So what kinds of documents will be covered in phase one? Many drivers have their driver's license in mind. They show their mobile phone, and that's how they can show their driver's license. People want to see that. So what documents will be covered in phase one? For more than 300 services on the platform, more than 90% of public services, a small fraction are private services, bank accounts, or services from medical institutions. So will we see more private services on I Am Smart in the future? So what are some struggles for private bodies in using I Am Smart, Undersecretary? We do have a target for the number of registered users. We have an ambitious goal, which wanted to have 2 million users by last year. By next year, we want to double that number, that is 4 million registered users. We will work hard towards the goal. We are confident about achieving this. We roll out enhancements to meet people's needs. That's our direction of travel. Now, on healthcare, it's important to help seniors sign up for the app. We want to encourage digital inclusion for seniors. We want this app to be a personal tool for seniors. Without effort, over the past year, much of the increase in registered users comes from seniors in terms of the age groups. Now, we don't have the breakdown. Out of the 2.7 million users we have, the age group 51 to 70 years old make up 1 million users. We will continue to focus on seniors. We will enhance our interface. There will be personalized settings. Seniors and other peoples with the need can pull up a simplified interface. They can adjust the text size. We will work with different district stakeholders. We also have a training scheme for seniors in IT. We also have a digital inclusion scheme for seniors. Those programs will feature the use of I Am Smart, on getting more private services to be on I Am Smart. Now, we go by categories. So we focus on the frequently used services, such as financial services, account opening, or buying an insurance policy online. People may need to apply for utilities. Those services are or will be on I Am Smart. Now, on the eMPF platform, there are services. We want people to be able to use I Am Smart to verify their ID, to view their details on eMPF. Now, for personal SIM cards, they have to go through real name registration. So that will also be covered by I Am Smart. Now, on the digital personal documents to be covered, we mentioned the senior citizens card, frontier permits, and also fishing licenses. Those will be covered. We are in talks with different departments so that we can cover those documents soon. Again, the goal is to bring greater ease to people. Mr. Tang Fei.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I support the early expansion of the I Am Smart app to cover more services. It's part of a broader trend to offer digital services as a way to bring greater ease to people. I have a question about Note 2 on page 4. Now, people can view different kinds of information, place allocation results of secondary primary schools, and the results of student grant applications. Now, people can file applications online, such as applying for driver's licenses. That's popular. But there are other cases where people can only view the outcome of an application, such as school places and travel subsidies. Will people be able to file those applications online through I Am Smart? People don't really need I Am Smart to view the results of, say, school place outcomes or the outcome of their travel subsidy applications. People already have quick and easy access to those outcomes. But being able to file those applications on I Am Smart with an interactive process, that will make a difference. Now, for the HKEAA or people filing Jupas and non-Jupas applications, there is a patchwork of apps. On school place allocation, that's a sensitive process because people don't want to see mistakes. People cannot use I Am Smart as a way to file those applications yet. Being able to see the outcome makes little difference. I Am Smart isn't handy if it just lets people see the results of their HKDSE or school place allocation. I'm not saying this app is useless. I'm saying, can we link up I Am Smart with other platforms? Or do we leave those specific functions to other platforms involving our education system? Where do you draw the line?
Thank you. We have one mind with the member. Now, some figures on students' usage of I Am Smart. They do use I Am Smart often. Smart Play, e-text, getting their driver's license. Last year, there were 1 million times of use of I Am Smart to apply for the working family allowance. People can view the outcome of their applications through I Am Smart. Now, there will be mini apps on I Am Smart. Those mini apps will cover different government services. The services mentioned by the member will be part of those mini apps. So, in the future,
people will not need dedicated apps. Instead, they will be able to go to those mini apps on I Am Smart. People will be able to file applications through those mini apps. Now, we will also have an enhanced version of eMe, so that will give people an easier time to make applications that will streamline the entire process. We also take an ambitious approach to those mini apps. On those interfaces and technical parameters, we share the details with different departments. So when those departments develop new apps, they have to give priority to making those mini apps available on our platform. And based on our parameters, those departments have to calibrate their apps accordingly. Departments will also have to review their existing apps and come up with a timetable for moving their existing apps to that I Am Smart platform so that those apps will become mini apps on I Am Smart. And then over time, departments won't have to create their standalone apps. I will have to extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Over to Mr. Chen Xiuhong. Thank you. Just like other members, cybersecurity is top of mind for me. Paragraph 15 says, independent third-party consultants are engaged from time to time to assess cybersecurity risks. Red team exercises will be done to guard against attacks and fix vulnerabilities. Regular review of vulnerabilities by white hat hackers. We now have 2.7 million registered users on I Am Smart, so there is already a huge amount of data. So the information security and cybersecurity risks are already there. So we shouldn't be waiting for the fourth quarter this year for such an audit. When you see something off, you should take action. You have to reassure the public. Now, on getting public and private bodies to adopt I Am Smart, more than 70 such services are already on I Am Smart. I've looked at the applications. They have to do with large corporations. There's an I Am Smart sandbox program. That's a great program for small and medium businesses to learn about how I Am Smart can be adopted for their services. The government is also working with Cyberport on a pilot scheme on the transformation for SMEs. There's matching subsidies for SMEs in digital transformation. So can we integrate everything? Can we have this integration scheme and also involve catering businesses and other SMEs? We integrate everything along with I Am Smart Plus and I Am Smart for Business. That way, with the digital transformation support pilot scheme, you can save the future efforts of businesses having to sign up on I Am Smart again in the future. Now, on private businesses, would there be businesses with ulterior motives using I Am Smart and NFC to capture more data, more personal data than what these businesses need? Of course, there are many legitimate businesses, but what measures do we have to ensure businesses access only the data they need? The CIO told us about the personal privacy data ordinance, but then there are people who want to commit criminal acts. Is there a way for us to guard against this?
GCIO, thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chen, for the questions. on cybersecurity, I thank Mr. Chen, and I'd like to respond by saying that we are also very concerned, and that is why we've incorporated all the measures to guard against cyber attacks on the original I'm Smart platform. With a wider adoption of I'm Smart by the public and more extensive usage, we believe that a major initiative should be introduced to step up security, and that is the introduction of the Red Team. Red Team will examine the system without any prior warning. So it will be a simulated reality. We also conduct log analysis with the use of AI. Now, it's a very complex system covering a lot of records. And we conduct analysis to preempt possible attacks and possible vulnerabilities. So by deploying AI, we conduct this analysis to step up security. So let me reassure members that last year, we adopted the ISO International Standard Certifications. We successfully obtained these certifications in relation to information security. So we will continue to do our utmost in information security and personal data protection. Now, about the sandbox program for SMEs and individuals, I would like to conduct tests on the services to be provided via I Am Smart. They can do so with the sandbox program. Apart from testing the operation of the system, they can also test for vulnerabilities. About the digital transformation support pilot scheme in collaboration with the Cyberport, we aim to help the beginners, so to speak, those who have not adopted any IT solutions. We help them procure basic IT ready-to-use IT package. So these enterprises may not be those which will be incorporated in IAM Smart in the near future, but rather the beginners. For sandbox program, we target the SMEs which may be providing professional services. They may need to authenticate the identity of staff and other authentication features, and they are already using I'm Smart. These major enterprises can help develop more applications of I'm Smart and help us promote that to the public. Some enterprises have make use of the I'm Smart sandbox program, and upon successful testing, they have incorporated the features in their own company system. Now, would it be possible that the property management or security company will get more will have access to more personal data than is necessary? The answer is no, because we only provide basic information of the person's identity for authentication. If more information is needed, the party concerned will need to actively ask the visitor for this information. Now, our regular examination or system testing for vulnerabilities will be able to detect any irregularity in relation to the personal code function. As for the NFC feature, only with government's approval will the app be able to read the face data of the ID card. So it's for the OGIO to provide authentication for the data stored in the chip of the new ID card to be read. And even with authorization, the feature or the function will only be able to retrieve the face data of the new ID card and not anything else. The authorization is given for the purpose of authenticating the identity and matching the data so retrieved with the with the data kept by the immigration department. Dr. Dennis Lam. In the information age, I'm Smart is a very important platform that can provide convenience to the public. First of all, I appreciate the government's efforts in developing the platform. I support continuous enhancement. Now, for doctors, we also need lifelong learning to keep ourselves abreast of the most updated medical knowledge. So, of course, continuous enhancement is necessary. We need to enhance capacity, performance, speed, and quality of I'm Smart. So keep up the good work. I understand that your target is to increase the number of registered users by 100% from 2.7 million to 4 million users. So it's a quite an aggressive target, but by 100% increase, it should be 5.4 million, not 4 million users. The next point is about promotion and publicity. Despite of a lot of efforts made, there is still a general lack of understanding of I'm Smart among the public. So you need to ramp up your publicity efforts. My final comment is this is a really important platform. It's also significant. So please keep up the good work. Thank you. Chair, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Lam, for your support. And thank you for having confidence in us. We'll definitely work towards enhancing the capacity, performance, quality, and speed of the system. About the number of registered users, in 2023, we recorded 2 million registered users. So we want to increase that by 100%. That means by next year, we need to increase the number to 4 million for Hong Kong residents aged 11 to 80. That's our target users. And we have 6.6 million in Hong Kong. So that target number represents a major share of this total number. Apart from gauging the effectiveness of the platform via number of registered users, we also consider the number of accesses. In 2023, we recorded this number. Now, apart from registering for an account, it is important that users use the platform. In 2023, we recorded 10 million accesses. It will go up further, and our target is to further increase this number by a number of times to 60 million. So, meanwhile, we seek to provide more services online by both government and private organizations, and we also would like to ask for your help to further promote I'm Smart to the public so that we can provide more services and bring more convenience to users and businesses. Mr. Li Chenkong. I'm Smart is convenient, but we want to make it even more convenient. And you need to gain public recognition that I am Smart is very convenient. So that's the crux of our discussion here. On user interface, I understand that efforts are being made to enhance user experience. I can tell you my personal experience. I've downloaded this app. I see some practical information on the homepage, but it doesn't tell you what to do if you want to apply for, say, licenses or file tax return. I think you've covered that point already. I do hope that in the future I will see the mini apps on the home page to help direct users to the pages they need. In fact, there are many mini apps that are successful on the mainland, such as Alipay and WeChat mini apps. These are used by not only the central government, but provincial, municipal, city governments, even the rural authorities. Apart from using the app as a messaging app, mini apps can also be provided to help enhance G2C communication. And on this note, my question is whether Hong Kong residents in the mainland will be able to use your platform, or do they need to use VPN? Will you also consider working with Alipay and WeChat? My other point is this. Will you consider providing personalized services for users to enhance experience? Say, I'm concerned about transport and traffic. Is it possible to make it as a hot pick in the menu? Will I be able to select the hot pick items and customize my own home page? And is it possible to use AI or chatbots? Will someone answer my inquiries on I'm Smart, in other words? The other point is about cross-boundary public services. I don't know whether government officials have tried this before. I tried that several months ago. I think this leaves much more to be desired, because it only directs you to another web page and then another process will follow. It requires you to authenticate your identity again. Supposedly, this page of Guangdong should be just one click away. I should not be required to fill in information again to verify my identity. In fact, I was even asked to show the resident permit. Who would like to take this question, please? Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Lee, for the questions. Let me respond to them. First, Undersecretary, I'm sorry. First of all, I need to further extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Right, please go on. Is it possible to allow users to customize the menu on I Am Smart based on their own preferences? This is something that we attach importance to. In the future, the new user interface will incorporate this new function based on the age group of the user, based on the preference of users. They will be able to list the frequently used items here and services that they prefer on the home page, which can help them access the services they need more quickly. Now, the member mentioned Hong Kong residents living in the mainland. We have conducted the relevant tests. They should be able to use I'm Smart. So, to answer the member's third question about the cross-boundary public services, we've been liaising with the Guangdong provincial governments, and we have been working on connecting I'm Smart and the Unified Identity Authentication Platform of Guangdong Province. So I'm Smart can help authenticate the user's identity. I think the member referred to a more seamless experience or better interface when the page is directed to the Guangdong Province platform. This is something that we can relay to the Guangdong Provincial Government to enhance user experience.
Mr. Lok Chong Hong.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First, a point about my experience. I'm Smart verifies the user's ID. People can access other systems through I'm Smart. So people can use Smart Play, for example. With Smart Play, you can book sporting venues. There have been several upgrades. Now, we thought we could stamp out those touting activities. But then from recent news reports and what people told me recently, we have been told that those bad guys have a new trick up their sleeves. With the new upgrades, people use other applications to engage in venue touting. So on Smart Play, can we enhance the functions of Smart Play to root out the use of AI or other illegitimate systems to game the system? Can we have a function on Smart Play to prevent the touting of venues with illegitimate systems? Now, on the fees for the use of I'm Smart for business services, every year I'm Smart takes $70 to $80 million for maintenance. Back in 2020, the government told us in the first 3 years, private businesses would not be charged for the first 3 years, and then there would be a review later. So, fast forward to 2024. Are there services on I'm Smart that are helpful and private businesses are willing to pay for? Now I turn to my next question about linkage with the mainland systems. We now have a connection with the Guangdong platform. When will we see cross-provincial government services? Many Hong Kong residents are in Beijing and Shanghai for studies and career. Now, on the illegitimate systems or plugins, the member mentioned enhancing Smart Play to guard against plugins and venue scalping. I'm Smart is just for ID verification. So this system is only for registration. On venue scalping, we will talk to the LCSD about possible ways to guard against those malpractices. The LCSD is working hard. They're doing something to guard against automated plugins. As Mr. Lok said, we have to move with the times in making greater use of technology. We have to strike a balance. An unduly cumbersome registration process will lead to public pushback. People will find the system too much hassle, and people will have to familiarize themselves with the system over again. So we'll talk to the LCSD about this, but this is beyond the scope of I'm Smart as a platform. Now, on businesses using I'm Smart, we want to encourage businesses to roll out services to make life easier for people through ID verification. So in the first 3 years, we do not charge businesses for using I'm Smart as a way to reach their users. As members suggested, we need more private services on I'm Smart. out of 370 services, 70 such services are from private businesses on IM Smart. So we will extend the current arrangement by 3 years. This means for three more years, businesses will not be charged for offering services on IM Smart. That's a way for us to encourage private businesses to roll out more services there. The goal is to ensure convenience for people in accessing both public and private services on IM Smart. This is to encourage greater use of digital services. Now, there was a question about cross-provincial government services. We have been in close contact with Guangdong about this matter. We already have in place connection between IM Smart and the Unified Identity Authentication Platform. Different provinces have this centralized platform of ID verification. Once that system is in place, you don't have to sort this out with each province. Once our system is linked up with the Guangdong platform, we will also establish links with other provinces. But at this point, the focus is to make life easier for Hong Kong residents to access services in the mainland cities of the Greater Bay Area. So we will start with the GBA, and that's our focus for now. Mr. Holden Chow.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I support enhancements to IM Smart. I have just one point to make. We're trying to make IM Smart more user-friendly. Now, paragraph 13 of the paper mentions digital personal documents. That paragraph mentions senior citizens' cards and other documents. So much information will be on IM Smart. 2 years ago, in the throes of COVID, we asked the government to give subsidies to people. One problem came up. People had to prove whether they were in regular employment, but the requirements varied from industry to industry. We can still recall the days when there was a tussle over who should get the subsidies. Of course, we don't want another pandemic. But since we have IM Smart, we will have so much information on IM Smart. Can we use this system to help us determine who will get future benefits? After all, the information will already be there on the app, and then we will have an easier time determining who should get the benefits payment. There were arguments over who should get the benefits. Those points are still fresh in our memory over who should get the payment. I know this will take time, but in the future enhancements of IM Smart, I'm wondering if the government can keep this in mind. With IM Smart, we will have an easier time in determining who will get certain benefit payments. Thank you, Madam Chair. That's a great idea. We will cover more digital personal documents in the future. That will mean more applications. People may apply for subsidies or other kinds of payments in the future. IM Smart will come in handy. As we cover more documents and more people use IM Smart, we can talk to different departments about linking up more systems. At the back end, we have the consent data exchange gateway. We also have eMe for form filling, ID verification is streamlined. That can go hand in hand with the digital personal documents. Mr. Dennis Lowe. I'm smart brings greater ease to people. But then there are people who have yet to sign up for the app. Say people apply for certain services in education, they run into problems. Say you need both parents with access to iAmSmart before they can countersign an application. There are peaks with certain applications. The OGCIO has been helpful. I hope there will be greater publicity of the app at schools so that more parents are aware of the service. Now, iAmSmart is just for verification. We just passed a bill on electronic traffic enforcement. People will get their notification through text messages or email. But for other government departments, even when they roll out electronic services, people are not aware of those services. So will the government step up publicity? iAmSmart does not notify people of anything. Say when I file my tax returns, many notifications have been sent to me, but I was not alerted to those notifications. I had to look up the information myself. With e-services, we also need AI-enabled functions. So when an alert has been sent out, and I don't have push notification on my mobile phone, once the system sees this, I want to get an email. But that is absent at this point. So there's a gap. We don't have enough publicity of iAmSmart in the community. Let's step up the work, and then more people will adopt this app. That can also show the government's resolve in moving its services to digital platforms. We're almost out of time. Let's extend the meeting for another 10 minutes so that the officials can answer Mr. Leung's questions. Undersecretary, thank you. Mr. Leung mentioned education services. We're working actively with different departments, and that includes the Education Bureau. There was a $2,500 subsidy. We worked closely with the Education Bureau on that. That was an example for us to tell parents about iAmSmart so that they could apply for that scheme. In the future, similar efforts will be made. Our goal is to have all government services adopt iAmSmart by 2025. The preferences in age groups and occupations of users will matter. Once the AI-enabled system sees that certain services may be suitable for a user, those services will be recommended. Of course, the users will also get to customize their own functions. There will be personalized alerts. Say a new service comes along, or a user has applied for certain services and has to pay an amount that falls due, there will be personalized alerts. These features will bring greater ease to people. Now, of course, we will also continue to step up publicity. We will work with professional bodies, district bodies, and also community service centers, elderly centers. Different associations organize events. We will work with these bodies. I thank members for their support and recognition of our enhancement of I Am Smart. I hope members can continue to help us promote I Am Smart. So that our enhancements will be more thoughtful, and then we can turn I Am Smart into a personal tool, and we can tell people about this tool.
Thank you. I thank the administration for answering our questions. So that wraps up the item 4 AOB, nothing under AOB, meetings adjourned.